Welcome to the Lorehounds. I'm Alicia.
And I'm Jean, and this is the MCUniverse, the Agatha prep episode.
We're mere days away from the start of Agatha All Along, aka the official start to Spooktober, which begins in September now, FYI, September 18th to be exact, with two episodes of this straight into my veins.
So today, using our comic book knowledge and frequent rewatches, we're going to recap the key MCU events you'll want to remember going into this show. So spoilers for anything that's happened so far in the MCU, starting now. Please watch WandaVision if you haven't.
And there's also going to be some comic book related spoilers. And after we recap what's already happened on the screen in the Avengers movies, WandaVision, and Doctor Strange and Multiverse of Madness especially, we're going to talk about what we know about this show's new characters based on promotional materials and comic books. Welcome to my favorite corner of the Marvel comic universe.
But we're going to save the biggest potential spoilers for last. That was a very sinister laughter right there.
Let's go for cackle.
Okay, but we're going to save the biggest potential spoilers for last, the third and final circle of spoilers, for anyone who wants to opt out in case what we know spoils any story surprises. But the comic readers think Marvel is trying to be really cute about something, and we're going to talk about that last.
For the record, though, for those of you who want to hear that last part, the MCU does tend to fall on the inspiration side of adaptation. So what we know about these characters is already quite different from the comics, as usual. And our hope is that we can help you recognize Easter eggs when they pop up in the show, since I doubt any of us know where this story is going.
Once the season starts, Alicia and I will be doing weekly episode breakdowns. So we definitely want to hear and discuss your thoughts about the show, the comics, the characters, everything as we go along. Please send your feedback to the MCU at thelorehounds.com. You'll find that link in the show notes. Voicemails are encouraged as well.
So yeah, Jean, when this episode goes out, we are less than a week away from Agatha All Along. What is your hype level for this show in particular?
Oh yeah, I'm pretty psyched for it. I feel like this part of the MCU, I want to explore a little bit more. I really enjoyed WandaVision. So getting to see some of the characters, that one of the characters come back in a major way is something that I'm looking forward to. I thought Agatha was a great character in that series. And continuing her story, I think is really cool. And continuing the story of some of the other elements, other characters that we saw in both the TV show and also some of the movies that we'll talk about later.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm very, I mean, obviously I said this is my favorite corner of the comics, my favorite corner that's of the MCU also. And I loved WandaVision because I'm also, not only am I a fan of the witchy characters, but the writing was just so in depth and nuanced. And I'm also someone who grew up watching a lot of different like classic TV and different genres of TV and stuff. So I just really appreciate that. And this is also, it has the same showrunner. Well, she wasn't called a showrunner at the time, but whatever. Jack Schaefer.
From the twisted minds of WandaVision, starring Katherine Hahn as the terrifying witch Agatha Harkness.
Join me.
Watch if you dare.
What happens next?
So I feel like it's going to be good again. It's just, yeah, and it's horror Halloween, but I know it's gonna be like a campy kind of horror, so it's everything that I want.
Yeah, and to be honest, full disclosure, WandaVision, it took a little bit for me to get into.
Okay.
But once I got into it, I think part of what was hindering me was that old timey feel that you loved. Mm-hmm. Right. So it took a little bit for me to get into that. And yeah. then once it ramped up, I really, it was really something to behold. Like you said, the writing was great. The character developments were really super. And they jumbled a lot of characters, but never in a way that it felt too much. Mm-hmm. It always felt like each character that they were introducing fit, right? It wasn't fan service. It wasn't something right. that was being done just to say, aha, look, we did this. It was part of a fitting narrative for the story. So I really appreciated what they did in that series.
Yeah. Yeah, and I know that this is also going to reference a lot of TV and films and stuff, but it's going to be more modern stuff. Like, for example, we know that the first episode, the working title was Agnes of Westview, and it's kind of a riff off of Mayor of Easttown. So, we're still getting that TV goodness, but I know I love the first two episodes of WandaVision. I just rewatched it this week, by the way. I finished the last episode this morning, and I didn't think that I would cry just as much as every other time, but I did.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Yeah. The show just really does it for me. And yeah, so I have a lot of hope for this. And we know this is part of what they're considering a TV trilogy of shows and of sorts. So we had WandaVision. Now we're getting Agatha All Along, and then we're getting a Vision show. I don't know. It was formerly called Vision Quest. I think they might have changed the title. I don't know. Anyway, we're going to offer some reading recommendations at the end of this first circle of spoilers for the key storylines of this trilogy. But these are stories that all lock together. So Jack Schaefer's not doing the Vision show, but I don't know, I'm still excited. You excited for that one
too? Yeah, I am. I am. Vision is one of my fave characters from the Marvel comics. And mm-hmm. it's also one of the fave characters of E, my 8-year-old. Mm-hmm. So he's gravitated greatly towards Vision for some reason. And I think that's really cool testament to the character itself and how he's been portrayed in multiple mediums, you know, because I come from the comic book Vision while E is mm-hmm. watching, you know, the cartoons, the animated stuff. And he's still drawn to it. So, I'm excited for the Vision show.
Yeah. Yeah. And I just want to put a disclaimer out there for just to set expectations that I think there's a 0% chance that Scarlet Witch will not return. She's definitely coming back in the MCU. It wouldn't be the most shocking thing if she showed up at the show, but I'm definitely not counting on it because like they've been saying, this is Agatha's show. And I think we should listen to them on that and let it be Agatha's show. And I'm honestly really excited about that. Not just that, but also the characters that they've pulled in. Most of them are from the comics. So this is going to be a really cool crew on its own. But that's not to say we are going to like recap Wanda's whole story and talk about that today because she's going to loom large over this show, even if she doesn't show up.
She's the reason for the show.
Yeah, basically. You know,
she's the reason for the show. So yeah, this mm-hmm. is, she may not be a screen presence, but her presence is all over the show.
Yeah. And what do you think? So WandaVision was plagued by, you know, everyone looking for Mephisto. Do you think this is Mephisto's? We know Mephisto's showing up in Ironheart, pretty much, played by Sacha Baron Cohen. Do you think Mephisto will show up here? And do you want him to? And Mephisto, for anyone who doesn't know, is a major demon that's tied to this whole story arc.
Will he show up? I don't think so. I am not. I don't think they're going to draw in like those major players for this show. I personally feel it's going to be self-contained to Agatha's story. Mm-hmm. And I just don't see it happening with the other major tie-ins to other series that might be coming along. So I don't think they're going to introduce that character at all.
Well, the showrunner did say there would be implications going forward, but also we have other ideas of what those implications might be that we'll talk about at the end. And we do. So I don't know. I think I'm with it with Wanda. Like Mephisto's coming. Mephisto is a big part of this overall story. I'm not holding my breath for him to show up here. And I'm not like going to be upset if he doesn't either.
Right.
Place a bet that we're going to get some major demon as like the antagonist along the way.
I mean, that would make sense, but he's like, you know, top tier level,
mm-hmm.
right? In the magic world. So he's almost sometimes referred to as the devil of the MCU. So mm-hmm. I don't know if they're reaching that far up the ladder to bring him into the show proper. So that's why I'm a little bit skeptical that he'll be in it, that they'll be in it. Because we don't know if they're going to, what gender Mystique is going to be.
So well, no, I think it's, that. I mean, I believe.
It could be Sasha, but it doesn't mean male.
Yeah. You know I think I mean? It's pretty much confirmed, but yeah.
Okay.
I'm as far as I know, but that's for Ironheart, which is going to be like a mix of like Iron Man and mysticism, wicked mysticism.
Well, that's going to be interesting.
Yeah. But we'll talk about the characters that are showing up, but one of them is connected to Man-Thing.
Ted, you have a lovely name.
So, I
your
think
favorite character, isn't it?
This is one of my tops, definitely. But this is because Man-Thing's already been introduced in Werewolf by Night, and if anyone hasn't watched it, oh my god, please
go watch it.
A classic horror. It's just so well done, like classic, as in just really making the references to the like 70s horror and even 30s horror. And yeah, it's, I think there's a good chance that he could show up.
Yeah.
That like on the witch's road as like a challenge or just peekaboo. How are you?
He's also a Nexus being.
Right.
Who's able to traverse, all these different planes of realities. So I would not be surprised if Man-Thing does show up.
Yeah, and in the comics, he has a psychic connection with one of the characters, or did, they have a strong connection, so often they show up together. In fact, they just recently both showed up in a Scarlet Witch comic together. Yeah, and there was a goat in the trailer. Remember who made a pact with the goat who sounded like a devil?
I made a pact with a demon that I cannot discuss. Otherwise, he said he would reap my soul and the souls of all I love, which honestly is so dramatic, and I hate drama. The demon, I think his name was Jake.
In a certain She-Hulk show?
Does that mean that she will be there? That's the question.
I would love if Madison showed up. That would be so fun.
I mean, she needs to come back, though.
Yeah, yeah.
They need to bring her back in some way, somehow, she needs to show up. Like that's like a killer character. Like you gotta have Madison back in the MCU.
I feel like it's been a minute since we had a Wong cameo too. So they could show up together.
Oh, that's interesting.
Yeah, because I just thought that was one thing that WandaVision did really well, is they just kind of put together. One of my favorite things about the show is just how we have Jimmy Woo, Monica Rambeau, and Darcy, who are just from three completely different parts of the MCU world.
Right,
but they had such like chemistry together, and they're just a really fun part of the show with their little team they formed. And that's the best thing about these comic books, is when you just have unexpected team-ups.
Team-ups, yep.
Yep. So you excited about the new characters? What you know about them so far?
Yeah, I am, but I'm kind of, I'm a little bit disappointed that one character that I was looking forward to hopefully was going to be included is not included. So
I saw your note from later, so I know.
Yeah, yeah. So I'm just, biding my time until, that part of the MCU magical realm is opened up. So yeah, we'll see.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, because there's some big ones that haven't shown up.
Yeah, there's like two big ones that, in the realm of magic, they need to be there. So it's
we don't have to be coy. We can say, the other big one I was going to say is Dr. Voodoo. And I guess you were going to say,
Both Marie. him and Marie Laveau. So,
Yeah. And I'm a big fan of her. I mean, how are they related again? But it's like an ancestor. Not a descendant of hers, I guess. Zoe Laveau is the living zombie. She's in one of my favorite comic runs, which will come up today, is the Midnight Suns with a U. It's just a 5-series comic run from 2022, I think. All right, so let's start our recap of everything that came before right after a quick commercial break. Okay, well, we wanted to first, before we get more into the new characters, we wanted to just remind everyone what happened before. So what is the actual story in the MCU of the characters who come into play? And we will be talking about Wanda and Vision, even though we don't expect them to show up, because as we said, these stories are all interconnected. So, and of course, yeah, just to shout out the actors. Wanda, played by Elizabeth Olsen, Vision, played by Paul Bettany, and of course, Agatha, played by Catherine Hahn. So, Jean, do you want to recap like what happens leading into WandaVision for these characters?
Yeah, sure. So, Vision is dead. I mean, Thanos is defeated, and I think Wanda has also lost her brother. And things have kind of broken for her.
Yeah.
And so I think she retreats into this reality at the beginning of WandaVision that we see. She's created a reality where none of that matters. None of that happened. So that's where we're at the start of WandaVision. And just, you know, a really quick thing is that the Mind Stone is super important, because that's how, you know, some say that's how Wanda's powers were activated. Some say that's how she gained her powers. I kind of happen to land on her powers were activated by the Mind Stone.
Or intensified,
Yeah. Like these are the innate abilities that she had, which the Mind Stone was able to bring out, just like it did in her brother Quicksilver. Pietro, and the Mind Stone was basically what gave Vision life.
Yeah.
So this Power Stone, this Infinity Stone, Infinity Gem, has connections to them, to the both of them, in who they are. So that's a common trait that we might see more of as we go in further in the MCU. Yeah. With these characters.
Yeah, and they point out in the show like how especially tragic Vision's death was, because he asked Wanda to kill him so that the Mind Stone, so that Thanos couldn't take the Mind Stone, and she did. So that's already, she had to kill the person she loves. And then Thanos just used a time stone to unwind that and killed him again right in front of Wanda. So it was like a double death. Yeah.
Very, very traumatic set of circumstances that she went through in the Avengers movies.
Yeah. Yeah, so she's in a bad place leading into WandaVision, and she kind of goes into this intense denial, and she creates this fantasy world for herself because she has this powerful chaos magic. She didn't even realize the extent of it until she just creates a new reality based on the TVs that, like, the TV shows she used to watch growing up with her family. And she traps an entire town in this reality with her, and they, like, don't have their own will, and they're forced to be these characters, and she keeps, like, switching genres and decades and stuff each week. And at one point, we have a character named Dottie who she... Agatha wakes her up, and she's like, "Oh, can my child please be friends with your children? Because, or just let her out of her room." Like, oh my God. So yeah, very intense, but she didn't mean for it to be that bad. But then, yeah. So we have all of this going on. And then, she kind of somehow, we'll talk about later about how this is done in the comics, but she manages to also will a version of Vision into, because he's dead and she doesn't even have his body, we find out later in the series, That's actually, the government had that body.
Right.
And they were like reassembling it and finally use her magic to reactivate that. But meanwhile, she's created, because she has that sliver of the Mind Stone in her. So she's created a new version of Vision. But he does have autonomy because he says no to her sometimes.
Yes. He's not just like a mindless, you know.
Yeah. Thing. Not just a fantasy that she, he is less under her control than other characters.
That is true.
Yeah. As are, she creates two children, twins, Billy and Tommy. And they, like, she goes through this super fast pregnancy and they grew up super fast. But then they have this ideal family, but it, she has to enslave an entire town to do this. You know, she has to.
Did she, though?
Did she have to?
She didn't have to.
She did it. Yeah.
But she didn't have to. She could have done those things that with Vision and her children since taking control of the entire town.
Yeah, that's true. Like, could she have just put... So she does this whole thing inside of a hex, which, get it, which, ha ha ha, but it's actually hexagonal shaped. So I guess, could she... She couldn't have let them leave, though, if she did the hex, or she would do the hex just around her own house, and then they couldn't leave their house.
I mean, she could have done that, and she could have created her own pocket reality, because essentially that's what she did in the house.
Right.
She created her own reality.
But then they're alone and they don't have neighbor. I mean, I'm not defending.
No.
This,
yeah.
But if
you go down, when I watched it, I always felt like she didn't have to do it the way that she did it. If she was able to, you know, bring back Pietro, bring back Vision, have children, then I don't think that she had to control the entire town in order to make it a reality. She could have created a town somewhere.
But can they not pass through the borders of the hex, though? Or if she could leave little gates. At one point she had little gates and it didn't make people disappear, her family disappear yet.
Right. So I think she didn't need to, you know, just take over the town in order to get the happiness that she wanted.
Yeah. But yes, she has also antagonizing her in WandaVision is, like, I call him Sword Murder Man, Tyler. I'm not going to learn his last name. And but then she's also got her allies outside who are like trying to thwart him. And then within, she has her neighbor, Agnes. And then it turns out Agnes is actually Agatha Harkness, who's a big witch from the comics who's often associated with her and is her teacher in the comics. And also she takes care of her kids in the comics. She takes care of especially Franklin Richards, the Fantastic Four kiddo. And so we have our Agatha All Along moment where we find out
who's been messing up everything.
It's been Agatha all along.
And including the fact that she has enchanted a man who played by Evan Peters, who is, so far we were given the name for him, Ralph Boner, but that seems to have been a joke. He seems to be the person that we hear Jimmy Woo and others referencing being their missing person who's under witness protection in this town. There's a deleted scene where he cuts off an ankle bracelet and escapes at the end. But it just so happens that Evan Peters is the actor who played Pietro, Wanda's brother, in the previous X-Men movies for Fox. So as soon as he started showing up, everyone's like, oh, is this an alternate universe version of Quicksilver? And the showrunners, I don't know. I have the idea that they didn't plan it that way, but I wouldn't mind if they ran with it now. Why not? We're talking about universes coming together. I would love to see that. But Agatha has him pose as Wanda's brother, even though it's a different actor. And, you know, Darcy's like, what? She recast Pietro? And Wanda is just so, she misses her brother so much that she's just willing to go along with it just because why not? Everything else is a confection. And if this gives her comfort, then, you know. But ultimately, that ruse is also revealed, and yeah, we don't see them interact anymore. I have some small wonder if he'll show up in this. I doubt it, but I wouldn't mind. That'd be cool. So then, yeah. So then we have her version of Vision, and then we have the government version that's restored physically Vision, and they've reactivated him, but he doesn't have any memories. And so the two Visions face off, and the her version of Vision, who was mad at her for doing this whole, you know, hex thing to the entire town, he ends up understanding like that it was out of this intense grief of having lost everyone she ever loved, and he ends up giving the other Vision. Who's now like drained of color, so he's called White Vision. He gives him his memories back after they do this little Ship of Theseus speech, and he flies off. So it'll be that White Vision that we see in the Vision show.
Never forget White Vision.
He looks cool. And then her family that she's created, you know, she has to let the town go, so she lets them fade away, and she battles Agatha, and she uses what Agatha's taught her about witchcraft and during this show against her, and ends up, you know, trapping her back in this persona as Agnes. She's like, this is the role you chose for yourself, this is the role you'll play. And so that's the position that Agatha is in starting this show. But we also learn more about, do you want to talk about Wanda's backstory that we learn about through this show?
I mean, the thing is, when I watched it, I'm always comparing it to the comics.
Right.
And her story, her character arc, although they do pull some things out mm-hmm. from the comics, like, you know, you could say... There are parts of it. Go ahead. Yeah.
I was just going to say like her parents. So her parentage in the comics is just very, it's like a complex, so complex. It's constantly a joke within the comics because they've retconned it so many times. But the closest version that would look like her parents. All right. How do I say this without having to explain the whole thing? She was raised by, in the comics, it turns out she was raised by her aunt and uncle. So it could be that the parents we saw are her aunt and uncle, and we'll have that revealed because I got one hint in when I was rewatching WandaVision. They gave us one hint that maybe another figure, her quote unquote real mother, would play a role in a future thing. But anyway, they even changed the names of those characters. So they like don't want us to think it's the same. They want us to know it's different.
Yeah, but my thing is, when for a large part of her existence in comic books and the lore, she and her brother have been mutants, right? Mm-hmm. They thought their father was actually Magneto.
Right.
That was their family. They recontacted them to no longer be mutants, to be, you know, inhumans. And Magneto was not their father. Now, in the current runs, they're trying to deal with Magneto because of the trauma and all of the issues that they have with their quote-unquote father, who may really not be their father. So right. There are layers upon layers.
And killed her brother. And yeah.
Right. So there's so many layers to her, mm-hmm. her character in the comic books. So what they did in the show... And simplify, what they did in the movies was drastically simplify her backstory. Mm-hmm. You know, they were found by Zemo. They were experimented on. That's how they gained their powers. They're still brothers and sister. They're still brother and sister as far as we know. And, you know, it's something that she didn't really train for, which is much like the comics.
Right.
In the comics, for a large part of her existence, mm-hmm. she's been spoken of as out of control, right? No more mutants. She's lashed out at the Avengers, quote unquote, mm-hmm. lashed out at the Avengers. She didn't have control of her chaos magic, right?
Mm-hmm.
Which is kind of what they've done on screen.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they show her to be at some points not really discerning about who she harms with her magic in a way that would tell you that maybe she's not really in full control of the magic, mm-hmm. right? It's a little, I don't know how to say it, but it's just, it doesn't make a lot of sense for me to watch her in the movies lose control the way that she loses control, because they didn't set up that character the way that it was set up in the comic books. It makes sense in the comic books. It makes sense for her to lash out. It makes sense. Everything that she does in the comic books makes sense. In the series and in the movies, the things that she does, I don't know if I buy the reasoning that she does the things that some of the things that she does. Hence why I say maybe she didn't have to enslave the entire town in order to make that reality come through. I mean, that's why I'm saying that.
Yeah. Well, I don't know if she couldn't have made that reality without enslaving the entire town, but she just didn't have to, you know, mind trap everybody. But right. but we do, I think the problem with the movies, and it's a problem with, you know, movie adaptations in general, is they just have to go through things so fast. So we, you know, obviously, and so the WandaVision show, one of the reasons why it was so great is it gave more time to linger in the character motivation. So we get more backstory about how, like her, how, you know, she was, we were told In Age of Ultron, we were told that, you know, she and her brother were radicalized by the death of their parents, but we got to see more of that, like that pain of them dying in WandaVision. And yeah, we get to see, you know, just they line up like the events, like this is all the things that have happened. And now on top of all of that, she goes through this growth arc and then, and then we get Doctor Strange, Multiverse of Madness. And I think, well, do you want to summarize what happens with her in that?
I mean, she becomes like the worst person imaginable. That's what she becomes. She becomes a terror, you know? And again, I really like Multiverse of Madness. I really enjoyed that movie. Yeah. I thought it was a very cool movie. I really enjoyed it. The one thing that I didn't enjoy was I didn't see the need for her to do the things that she did in the film. Like her rampage across the universe, you know, just willy-nilly killing, you know, going on a killing spree. I just didn't feel that. I didn't understand it. Her rage, her, you know, of trying to bring back her children, which caused her to go down this really dark path. I just didn't see the need for it. Because once she encountered different versions of herself, right, and saw how those versions were dealing with whatever trauma that they had in their lives and making a go of it, I didn't understand why she would in turn say, okay, no, you know, I'm still going to go down this very dark path that she went down.
Yeah. So I think there were two problems, I think. And one is that they filmed it at the same time as WandaVision. So you couldn't react to what was going on in WandaVision. So that it creates a little bit of the disconnect. And I think the other problem was apparently earlier versions had spent more time with her, like showing how she was being corrupted by the Darkhold. I don't think we've mentioned the Darkhold is one of the, or the probably biggest evil book in
Marvel Universe.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And it's a book that's tied to this demon C'thun, which is like a demon that's tied to Scarlet Witch. So she, you know, she was so obsessed with getting her kids back that she gets corrupted by it. And they didn't spend the time on it because they wanted to get to the cool stuff. And the cool stuff's cool. You know, right. she goes like on a multiversal murder spree, and that's awesome. I love that for her. But it was so jarring after WandaVision. Yes. It was just like, wait, Whiplash. And then, yeah, she dies, or seemingly at least dies. I think she probably does die, but, you know, Marvel characters don't have to stay dead.
Right.
And she dies in this temple of C'thon, the Darkhold Castle on Mount Wundagore, which is like an important comic ties. But I think they could fix this, to be honest. I think they underutilize the special presentation format, and I want them to create a fun special presentation of like Wanda getting corrupted by the Darkhold. You know, the special presentations last less than an hour. Just have like some Wanda and C'thon, you know, caper, and we just see what he promises her and why she.
Because in the comics, that's her big bad.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You know, that is her big bad. That Elder God is her main nemesis because of her chaos magic. Mm-hmm. Right. And she even defeats him and takes his him power into her. Into her. So.
And then she does it.
Right. And, but she doesn't go on a murder spree.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Well, actually, I mean, she killed all mutants, or, you know,
that was before.
That was an oopsie.
That was before. That didn't happen yet. You know what I'm saying? That happened before. Mm. So when she, you know, declared all mutants, that's more akin to the grief that she was feeling at the loss of her children than I could understand doing what she did in WandaVision.
Uh-huh. Right?
I think those two stories might have more in common because, you know, no more mutants. No more mutants is when Wanda broke.
Yeah.
Her she realized her children were gone, mm-hmm. and all the horrible things that had happened in her life, she blamed on her being a mutant.
Right.
So in that moment of grief, her chaos, she let out her chaos magic and let out a spell that said no more mutants. Mm-hmm. And almost 99% of mutants on the face of the earth were depowered. Mm-hmm. They weren't killed. They were just depowered. They were no longer mutants. So there was a big...
But that was worse than what years. She did to Westview, right?
So. Oh, yeah. On I don't know because... When she said no more mutants, it wasn't a planned thing.
Mm-mm. Nor was Westview.
I think Westview was
an oopsies.
Westview was an oopsie.
No, because she explicitly says it also, because Vision confronts, and you can see also when you can see it evolving where she's starting to realize.
Yes.
And then, you know, she's confronted by Agnes and Agatha, you know. And she's confronted by Vision, and then she actually talks about it with Vision because they love each other. They're not back together in the comics, by the way. Sorry, but that's bullshit.
They haven't been together for a while.
I know. It's comics. Been decades. Yeah,
it's been a while. It's been a while.
But I think they have to in the MCU. They're just so perfect. But anyway, she has a conversation with him where she admits she, you know, because he's like, I think you didn't know it at first. And she's like, yeah, I didn't know it. I should have stopped once I started to realize, but then
I couldn't stop.
Mm-hmm.
Right. I didn't want to stop.
Yeah.
I didn't want to stop. I think it's different when, you know, one, we could see she was being manipulated by Magneto,
mm-hmm.
right, to keep the spell.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Magneto actively encouraged, pushed her to do it. And then was instrumental in keeping that entire spell going. So the lack of, as you said, the Darkhold corrupting her,
mm-hmm.
we don't have that. So in the series.
It's only hinted at. I mean, it's that hinted is at. Canon, yes, it's hinted. But they didn't show it. Yeah.
Right. They didn't show it. So I'm left to see what I'm seeing and saying that this is all on her own device, that she knows what she's doing.
Mm-hmm.
She may, you know, at some points regret what she did, but in the end, at the end of things, she knew what she was doing.
Mm-hmm.
In a way that in the Noma Mutant storyline,
right.
It's not.
Right.
It's like a snap judgment type of thing.
Mm-hmm.
not something that's really like, oh, I want to bring back my family. How do I do it? Which I felt is how it was portrayed in the series.
Yeah.
It's a little bit different.
Yeah. I mean, I think like they got Sam Raimi, the director of Multiverse of Madness, to do a Sam Raimi movie. And he did that great. Like, as far as Sam Raimi-ness, it was perfect. I loved like all the cool, creepy stuff that she does in that movie is great. It's just, it doesn't make sense as a follow-up to WandaVision. So give us the one shot. Are you listening, Feige? Let Jack Schaefer do it. Or Michael Giacchino after he's the composer who did directed Werewolf by Night. And that was great. That was perfect.
Right. Yeah.
So, by the way, fun random thing that I was rereading some comics, to prep for the show. And one of the series that I reread is the Man-Thing Adventure in a Fear series from the early 70s because that's the introduction of one of the characters in the show, Jennifer Kale. And so one thing I noticed in this, it's her full origin story. So one thing I noticed in it is that when she's being advised, she starts to have nightmares and she's told that her nightmares are of other dimensions. So I was like, oh, that's like a Multiverse of Madness. They said that.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Interesting. Mm-hmm. I wonder if they knew.
Well, I wonder if they pulled it from
that's
that
what I'm or, saying. If they knew of the history. And
yeah.
That's really interesting.
Wow. Well, somebody's obviously reading Jennifer Kale comics because she showed up.
Yeah, there you go. That's true.
So yeah, before we're going to give you some comic recs for the trilogy of TV shows in just a moment, but just to cover Agatha's backstory in the MCU, which again, quite different from the comics, but some overlap. So in the comics, yes, she's not originally from Salem. She's much older than that, but she did live in Salem, Massachusetts. And so in the MCU, we learned in WandaVision that, yes, she was in a coven with her mother and others, her group in Salem, back during the witch trials era. And she ends up being captured by her own coven because they say that she is, being corrupted. And
it's too they powerful.
She's too, and they try to drain her of power. And she ends up, it almost breaks my heart, but you don't know whether to trust her. She's like, I can be good. She's more wicked in the TV shows than she is.
Oh, yeah.
The
no. It's a totally departure from the comics. Yeah.
I don't hate it, though. As long as they're consistent in universe, then, you know.
Yeah.
But yeah, so she ends up draining the coven instead of them draining her. So that's the kind of character that she is. And she is sometimes in covens in the comics, but in the TV show, she's like very anti-coven.
Right. Right. Yeah. And in the comics, she leaves Salem, goes to New Salem, which we'll talk about a little bit, founded
in Colorado.
Colorado. So she's not anti-coven at all in the comic books.
No. Yeah. So speaking of the comics, what are you saying is like the top recs for people who want to know more of the story behind WandaVision?
I think you hit it spot on in the notes. Vision and Scarlet Witch, House of M.
Yeah, we put together the notes together.
Yeah, House of M. Mm-hmm.
And Avengers Disassembled is actually how Vision gets disassembled, and Wanda does it.
And Wanda does it, right.
It's crazy.
And then Vision, the Tom King.
Yeah, Volume 2 series. From 2015.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And we have a... I really think that Tom King Vision comic book influenced the series, because in that comic, it's Vision who is trying to have a family.
Create a new life. Yeah. But I wonder, that's why I wonder if, because I put it, so listeners, we were discussing this one in particular. I put it originally under the Vision series as a reference for that, because I was wondering if this might be something he does next, because this is something that happens after they go through. So Vision and Scarlet Witch from 1982, this is where you're going to see them like creating the kids. And this is where, and then we, we eventually find out, it's all over the place. A lot of it takes place in like Fantastic Four stuff because of Agatha, and a lot of it, Agatha's deeply tied to Fantastic Four comics. A lot of it takes place in random Avengers comics. But so they have these kids, and then basically they find out that they are actually pieces of Mephisto's soul that Wanda willed into being. And they end up taking them. They end up they're dissipated. The kids are gone, kind of like the show. And then Agatha erases Wanda's memory so that she doesn't have to deal with it. And then Wanda remembers at some point, and that's she snaps. And she ends up killing Agatha. She ends up killing Vision. She, a lot of stuff goes wrong.
And they want to kill her. And the Marvel superheroes are saying, no, we got to get rid of her.
Yeah.
They went to, we got to get rid of her. Yeah. And Magneto and Quicksilver were the two who stood steadfast against her being murdered.
Right. Her brother and her father?
Not her really. Father. I mean, I still think Magneto's her dad. Daddy. So
dad. Yeah. I mean, except for, and the uncle that raised her is not a kindly man like in the TV show, the father who raised her.
Right.
He's a bad dude. It turns out. But then, okay. So basically, if you want that story, like the highlights are the Vision and Scarlet Witch series from 1982. I think that's volume one, I guess. Avengers Disassembled, which is an event in 2004, and the House of M series in 2005. It's that. Yeah. And then, Jean also mentioned the Vision series. And then for Agatha, which is one of the main comics we know that they're pulling from for Agatha All Along, is the Witch's Road comic, which is basically Scarlet Witch Volume 2, which involves her walking the Witch's Road. Agatha is there with a ghost because, again, she had killed her.
As a ghost, yeah.
Yeah. But spoiler, Agatha ends up coming back at the end. So it is a key series for Agatha as well. And there's also, we'll talk about some other character crossovers in there that's going to be relevant for this TV show. And another thing is I was listening to the official Marvel podcast, and they announced that they released a new collection of Agatha comics called Saga of a Salem Witch. And so just the fact that they're releasing that right now tells me that they're saying, pay attention to these particular comics.
Yeah.
So we have Fantastic Four from 1961. Number 94 is where Agatha's first introduced as Franklin Richards.
Nanny. Yeah.
Yeah. And then we have 185 to 186, which is the introduction of the Salem Seven. We'll talk about them more in a little bit because they are going to be a version of them is going to be antagonists in the Agatha All Along series. And then also 222 to 223, a Fantastic Four volume one is the Salem Seven comes back basically. And then they recommend Avengers 1963, number 128. And that's the one where she first becomes Wanda's teacher.
Wanda's teacher.
Yeah. She leaves her job as a nanny and says, no, I need to take care of someone else. I'm going to teach Wanda how to witch. And then they jump forward to that Midnight Sun series that I mentioned from 2022. And because that is where Agatha, she ends up de-aging at the end of that basically, but I wonder, I'll bring up some other things when we talk about antagonists. I wonder if they might pull from that Midnight Suns with You series.
Interesting.
Yeah.
So for the Vision series, read West Coast Avengers Vision Quest from 1985 and also West Coast Avengers Volume 2. And plus, again, the Tom King Vision series from 1516. Which, that's a highly recommended comic by me, Comic Run.
Yeah.
Tom King did a tremendous job in that storytelling for that series. So definitely independent of these shows, that's something to read.
Yeah. And also in the West Coast Avengers and the Avengers West Coast, which are actually just two different names used in different parts of the same group. I don't know.
Just the same makeup. It's the same makeup.
They have some weird naming conventions for the comics sometimes that are confusing. But Wonder Man is a big role in this whole story too. And there is going to be a Wonder Man show. So that's something to pay attention to as well. All right. So I think, I don't know, anything else you want to say about prepping on this overarching story or what has already happened in the MCU before we get into the preview of what's to come?
No, I think that's pretty much a great nerd out that we just did. and yeah, let's talk about what we expect from this coming series.
All right. So we're going to take a quick break, but this is your official spoiler warning. When we're back, we are going to be talking about speculation based on promotional materials from Agatha All Along, but also comics. We'll save the biggest potential spoiler for last again, but just FYI. See you in a second. So Agatha All Along is starting in less than a week. And like we said, same showrunner, Jack Schaefer, as WandaVision. It's going to be filled with TV and film references again. I've been going all in on prep for this. Like, I use it as an excuse to rewatch a bunch of stuff. I've watched Mare of Easttown for the first time. I rewatched the original Suspiria and watched the new Suspiria. Yeah. I watched The Wiz just in case. I rewatched it. I've been all over the place prepping. I've been very excited about this one. Yeah. Nice. So I'm ready to pick out the TV references. We'll obviously be shouting them out in our weekly breakdowns. The title game that they played leading up to this, they stretched out this gag for years.
Man. Every time a new one came along, I was filled with dread that the series was going to be kaput. Because you can't keep renaming. I was so worried, like, oh my gosh, they renamed it. They're pushing it back.
Yeah.
And lo and behold, none of that was true. Thank goodness. So here we are, less than a week out from getting the show on our screens.
Yeah. So at first they said it was called House of Harkness. And then they let that stand for like a year. And then it was Coven of Chaos. And then that stood for like a year. And then they're like Darkhold Diaries. And we're starting to get nervous. And then the last one, they only had this one up for a day. The Lying Witch with Great Wardrobe. And we were like, come on, you're trolling us. They're like, yeah, we're trolling you. It's been Agatha all along.
She's insidious. So perfidious. That you haven't even noticed that.
So it's going to be 9 episodes in total, the series. The first week 2 drops, so 8 weeks in total. And we're promised it's going to be like pretty proper scary, like actual Halloween-y stuff. And we see some demon-looking creatures in the trailers, so it's promising.
It does. It's exciting to get something different.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I'm all for different. Hopefully they can pull it off, but I want, you know, different. I don't need to see the same thing being replayed on screen over and over again. The same tropes, the same story arcs. I don't need all of that. It's nice to get something different.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and Catherine Hahn said also that there's going to be a focus on practical effects, even how they do the magic. So that's exciting. I'm always...
Yeah, that is. That is.
Yeah. And the composers from WandaVision are back too. So we have Christoph Beck doing the overall composition, and then Kristen Anderson Lopez and Robert Lopez, who are doing like the key songs. So the first season, they were the ones who did the changing theme songs, and they're the ones who did the song Agatha All Along. And so far, we've gotten this for this show. So far, we've gotten the Witch's Road song, which I'm loving. It's stuck in my head.
I stray not from the path. I hold Death's hand in mine. Down, down, down the road. Down the witches, down the witches, down the witches, down the witches,
down the witches, down, down, down. So, yeah, I think we're going to get some more music, too.
Yeah, I think, and that's great, because what they did on Vision, WandaVision, was really awesome.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, and it seems like the premise is that Agatha, she has lost her powers because of all that WandaVision stuff, and she needs to walk down the witch's road to the end to get her powers back. But she can't do it on her own now because she doesn't have powers. So she needs a coven of 6 witches. And it seems this is slightly different from the comics, but that's to be expected. It seems like she needs 6 witches with different sets of powers to enter the witch's road together. So, yeah, she has to. I guess the first part of the show is going to be her convincing these disparate characters to team up.
That's going to be. Yeah. The thing is, I don't get me wrong. Mm-hmm. I love a good team up, mm-hmm. but the whole pulling the team together, like the A-team, sometimes that's a little draining on me. Sometimes it's a little draining. Hopefully this is not one of those times.
I'm super excited about it because it's also how we're going to get to know the different characters.
To learn about the characters. Yeah, definitely. Yeah. But sometimes I'm just like, give me the stuff. Mm-hmm. I want the stuff. Give me the stuff that I want.
This is the stuff. This is the stuff that I want.
I want the stuff. I want the other stuff.
I think this stuff means more to me if we set it up properly, you know? So yeah. I'm looking forward to this. Yeah. And so the coven, we've got Agatha is one of them. So, yes. Like I said, we're going to save Joe Locke, seems to be the second lead, but we're going to talk about his character last for spoilery reasons. So the person who seems to be the third lead is the character I've already referenced, Jennifer Kale, played by Sashir Zamata. And, apparently in the show, Jennifer Kale is an alchemist, which is a potions witch.
Jennifer Kale, potions.
Her magic comes from chemistry and alchemy.
You look amazing.
I know.
So that's a bit different from the books where like her legacy is more tied to conjuring. And but basically, so her family legacy, they have their own book, this tome of, what is it, Zemet? And this is a book that conjures demons, and a lot of her story is tied up with that. So, yeah, this is going to be different. Whatever. Looking forward to it. This is one of the more frequently recurring witch characters in the comics. And so dating back to some of the earliest Man-Thing comics in the 70s, like I said, from the trailers, you know, even though her backstory and stuff might have changed, it seems like her attitude matches. With, you know, she's definitely got a lot of attitude, and she's in the comics, she's the cousin of Ghost Riders, Johnny Blaze and Danny Ketch, not like first cousins, but you know, they're kind of family.
Somehow related, yeah. A little bit.
Yeah. They've got a common descendant, a Kale.
I think she was introduced to help like Dr. Strange.
If I remember correctly. Yeah. Dr. Strange, he introduced her to them. To help with some Furies were going after. So this was like when Danny Ketch was Ghost Rider, and it turns out that their ancestor is the spirit of vengeance who is possessing him. And there were some Furies after him because of a role he played in the death of his wife or partner. Yeah. But yeah, as I said, she's most associated with Man-Thing. So I think that
they have a psychic link in the comics. Mm-hmm. Like their links.
No, yeah, she's an empath in the comics also. She's so also in the early comics, she has these toxic, terrible boyfriends. And then in the later comics, she's a lesbian. So I'm curious. I do think that the actress is a queer actor. So I don't know if Disney's going to dare to lean into that because Disney's had a track record of shying away from that. But it's there. It's there.
Let's see.
There might be references. And we know that in the show, the first witch's road trial is going to be hers. So apparently there's going to be like different episodes for the different witch's road trials of the different, you know, members of the coven. So, and they compare the first one to Big Little Lies, which is an interesting vibe for her.
I never saw that show. Bougie. I never watched it. Okay. Never watched that show.
It's a good show. It's a good show. But it's very bougie. So that's not her. She's a swamp witch in the comics, like not like a swamp hag or something. She Her grandfather is a cult leader of, and they, you know, a cult around this book that I mentioned. And so this is where, you know, through that legacy is where she gets her powers and the access to, you know, the magic, magical world in the first place. So yeah, it's a very different vibe.
Okay.
Yeah, because she lives next to Man-Thing in the Florida swamps. Yeah.
In the Everglades.
Yeah. So if you are curious about Jennifer Kale and you want to learn more about her, the key comics I already mentioned, she's introduced in Adventure into Fear, which started in 1972, and she's in the issues 11 through 19, which are the Man-Thing issues. And this is also, by the way, the first introduction to Howard the Duck. Just you all need to know that Howard the Duck and Man-Thing are best friends in the comics. This is important to me that you know that. And then the Ghost Rider, the story that we were just talking about a moment ago, is Ghost Rider Volume 3. And these issues are from 1996, and it's number 77 through 81 is the main story we were talking about. But she like recurs through 89, issue 89. I also recommend there's just a four issue series called Witches from 2004. And she's the only character from the show that's in it, but I just think it gives a really good insight into her character. And I should also mention she has a brother who dies in that series. And so I don't know. I'm just wondering if they'll mention her brother. And she turned up in Scarlet Witch Volume 3, 2023, number 9 with Man-Thing, as I said. And she's also, she tends to show up on the horror side. She also shows up in some Marvel Zombies comics and a bunch of other stuff. So, yeah, she's one of the more prolific ones. Are you a Patti LuPone fan?
Yes. And I'm happy to see that she's in this series. I think she's great.
Yeah,
and I think this role that she's playing is perfect.
Mm-hmm.
Lilia Calderu, divination.
I have flashes of sight, of vision.
She's kind of batty and all over the place.
Yeah, I'm excited. She's playing Lilia Calderu. I think she's Sicilian in the show, but she is in the comics. She's Eastern European, and she's tied a bit to Wanda's origin. But she only appears in four comics, so this is like a real deep cut. In the most recent comic, which was the Mystic Arcana Scarlet Witch comic from 2007, she is tied to Wanda's like ascension as a witch as a child, which is another retcon of Wanda's backstory. But before that, she appears in Marvel Premiere Volume 1 from 1973, issues 12 and 13, and Doctor Strange Sorcerer Supreme Volume 1 from 1989, issue 8. And in both of those, she is the quote unquote witch queen of the gypsies. And of course, they did too much stereotyping with like the Eastern Europeans. So I can see why they're backing off of that in the MCU.
Yeah.
But she's most tied to Baron Mordo, who's played by Chiwetel Ejiofor in the TV show. And I don't see there being a romance between these two characters in the MCU.
No.
I can't see that happening.
No. We don't even know where Mordo is. And, mm-hmm. you know, and this is what I do appreciate. I do appreciate that we're getting these characters who are not very well known. But a lot of times the characters that are not very well known have problematic beginnings to their comic arcs. And I'm happy to do away with those problematic beginnings of characters. So hopefully this is a departure from what we've known of the character. And, you know, we get to explore something new, something fresh, something that doesn't, it's not cringe.
Yeah. Yeah. And so she, in the show, apparently her power is divination, and she seems to be referred to as a high priestess. So, another deep cut from the comics is, and this one seems probably a little more on brand, but this is also a more recent character, thus a little less problematic. We have Alice Wu Governor, played by Ali An. And in the show, she says she's like her specialty is blood magic or protection, which kind of dovetails with her in the comics. She only appears in four comics as well. So she first appears in The Last Days of Magic, the 2016 series by Jason Aaron. Thank you, Sean, for adding the name there. And she shows up in three of the issues of that Witch's Road, you know, that Scarlet Witch Volume 2 comic that keeps coming up. Right. And in the comics, she's from Hong Kong. And she is the daughter of, her mother is August Wu of the Coral Shore, who's a powerful sorceress. And
the protector of Hong Kong.
A protector of Hong Kong, yeah.
The protector, the magic protector of Hong Kong.
And her father's a different type of protector. He's Detective Sergeant Adam Gulliver.
Yeah.
So he's a policeman. So when her mother dies, she wakes up. Her mother has like, in the first comic she appears in, her hair actually looks the color coral. And I think that's much cooler because they make everyone freaking blonde or redhead in the comics. So they have her wake up with coral or red hair one day. And that's how she finds out that her mother's dead and she's now inherited her mother's powers. But she's like, I'm not like this. Her mother's like floating, beautiful ballerina style. And she's like, that's not me. I'm not this fancy name. I am just going by the Wu. And she doesn't want people to know she's a sorceress. So she just enchants like her weapons. So she's a cop, but she just enchants her guns. So she just looks
magic
like she's
magic bullets.
She's a very good cop. It's what it looks like.
Magic bullets. Yeah. Let's just call it that. Yeah.
Yeah. So
I want to see magic bullets in the TV show. I'm not going to lie to you.
Yeah. No, I think that they'll probably keep her story closer because like that's already such a strong, specific story.
Right. Right.
Alice, how did you?
I'm an ex-cop. It's going to be the answer to a lot of questions.
I'm excited for that. Yeah. It's magic in plain sight. And, yes. And I like how it combines her parental legacies, you know. She's like, I am both of my parents, but I am also my own person, something new.
And I get to, you know, walk my own road.
Yeah, exactly.
That pun was intended, actually.
And then, other than Joe Locke, which again we'll get back to in a moment, the last member of the coven is Sharon Davis, who was AKA, she was known as Mrs. Hart inside the Hex in WandaVision, played by Deborah Jo Rupp. And she is a quote unquote green witch, but I'm getting the idea from the promotional materials and from seeing her in WandaVision that she's like, she's just collateral. A gardener and they're like desperate for, they're just desperate for a green witch. Yeah, I don't know if she's going to survive. Oh.
Gang's all here.
Wait, where's our green witch?
Oh, I know who it is.
A party? I'm going to grab my purse.
Looks like you've got your coven.
What a team of rejects.
I think a funny detail is like when you see them sing the song, she only sings the chorus. And in an interview, that's on purpose because she's the one who's just like, what am I doing here? Where am I? What's going on? She's like the only major character other than Agatha carrying over from WandaVision, it seems. But we're going to get glimpses of, you know, so Sarah Proctor was Dottie inside the Hex. John Collins was Herb inside the Hex. Sarah's husband. We had Abhilash Tandon was Norm inside the Hex, you know, Vision's buddy at work. And we got the delivery man back. Agatha's mother is returning, which is interesting. But I kind of would expect it. So I'm guessing more backstory. Or maybe she shows up on the Witch's Road like Wanda's mother does.
That's interesting.
And the sheriff is back. Are there any other characters from WandaVision you hope to see or?
No.
These might just be like only in the first episode, to be honest.
Yeah, I want this story to mm-hmm. just focus on what it needs to do with Agatha.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't need the side characters from WandaVision. I don't need them to show up in this story because I think we've done that, right? And they're gone for me, you know.
Yeah.
Multiverse of Madness was the final piece of that, you know, part of Wanda's story. Mm-hmm. And this is not Agatha's story, so I want to see that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, I'm glad that, you know, they're picking up, like, it ties in. It's clearly in the same town, but then they're diverging and going, because the witchy realm shouldn't be limited to one town unless it's, you know, Wanda's going through a hard time with her grieving.
Right.
So another character who's not expressly part of the coven, but I have a feeling is going to be replacing poor Sharon Davis, because she is a green witch, is at Aubrey Plaza is playing a character named Rio Vidal. And there's hints that there were rumors that they were, that the two characters were married, but I think they might have in the past. So they're exes. But I think they might have had to take out explicit references to that. But from what I've heard from people who've seen the opening episodes, there's like an electricity between them that's exciting to watch as a viewer.
What's up? I'm Rio.
What's Hello. Up?
Hey.
They just think I'm some kind of badass.
Do I hate her or do I want her phone number?
But yeah, she's a green witch. She pops up and it seems like based on the trailer, she's in a lot of it. She's an original character, not really from the comics, but some say maybe she's partly based on Gaia, you know, the goddess from the comics. Maybe she's partly based on a character who appears in just a handful of comics called the Emerald Warlock, but then definitely like getting rid of the problematic background thing here again, where it's not just like an Irish stereotype.
Right.
Because she's not Irish, first of all, but you know, it has earth powers and yeah. But if you are curious, Emerald Warlock, I do recommend starting with Uncanny Avengers Volume 2 from 2015 to see the beginning of his story, because it is a doozy, the beginning of the story. It's very good. And then, yeah, this is a character who again shows up in a whole bunch of the Scarlet Witch Volume 2, the Witch's Road comic series. So
if you read one thing,
yeah,
read that. But Rio Vidal is probably the character I'm most interested in because it's new. She's new. You know, it's I don't know. I want to know this backstory. I want to know who this person is and what their connection to Wanda, Agatha, to magic is. I want to explore that. And I think Aubrey Plaza is great as an actor. So I just, yeah, I want to know Rio Vidal and see what makes the character, because right now I don't. Everything is speculation.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah. I'm glad to be speculating. You know what I mean? And I want to be pleasantly surprised. So hopefully they can pull off this character that's, you know, kind of new to the MCU.
Yeah. Yeah. And so of course, I guess I first met quote unquote Aubrey Plaza in Parks and Recreation. That's probably where I first saw her. But where she really popped for me was in the TV show Legion, which is a Marvel show, but in a different part of the multiverse. And she plays this completely unhinged character there that's just like so delightful. I really recommend that show for anyone who hasn't watched it. But if she's bringing, I think she is bringing a similar energy to this role, and that's going to be very exciting to watch.
Yeah, definitely.
And the other antagonist that we know we're getting is the Salem Seven. And in the comics, Agatha has a son named Nicholas Scratch, and he's not good news. He's bad news. And he had seven different children with seven different mothers, and they became the Salem Seven, and they all have like different powers and different like shticks about them. Like there is Serpentina, there is, I forget all of their names off the top of my head. In the show, they're definitely changing it. Apparently, they're not all associated with animals, although there is like gazelle and there's a snake one and stuff. But in the show, they are apparently going to all be associated with different animals. So I think they might be like shifters even, is my guess.
That would be fun.
Yeah.
Because the transformations, if they do occur, I'm looking forward to that.
Yeah. Yeah. Do you want to summarize like their whole thing in the comics?
Yeah. So, you know, they're, like you said, they're the children, they're Agatha's grandchildren in the comics. And we first come to know them when they, you know, effectively put Agatha on trial to kill her because they feel that she has betrayed her coven, her of New Salem, Colorado, the coven that she founded after she left Salem during the aftermath of the witch trials. So, yeah, like you said, they're bad news. Family is something, man, in comic books and superhero stories.
Yeah.
You know, I can't even imagine, you know, trying to off my grandmother. Like, what are we doing? What are we doing here? Somebody got to stop this madness. But so it'll be interesting to see the first show up in, I think it was the Fantastic Four.
Yeah.
1977, number 186. Yeah, number 186 we have it in the notes. I'm sorry. And and they also show up in Vision and Scarlet Witch, Volume 2 in 1985, numbers 3, 4, and 5. And
so there's this other one that I just read this one for the first time recently. Which, so they show up more often than I realize, and I haven't read them all yet. But the one I read recently, it's a Fantastic Four comic, but it's just called Four. It's actually super difficult to Google because of that. But yeah, it's from 2005 and they're in issues 25 through 27 and 30. And by the end of that, they actually become allies with the Fantastic Four for a short while.
Yeah. I don't know. You know, it's comics made strange bedfellows. Let's just say that.
So I realized I was looking up like what are the more recent comics that they've been in, and I do plan to. I'm going to dive into those before the show too, just in case. But I noticed Fantastic Four Volume 1 ran for 55 fucking years. So they actually appear in the finale, and which is number 645, issue number 645. Which was, I think, in 2015. Like, so those it went
fun,
from...
Those are fun. That's fun times, man.
55 years for one volume of Fantastic Four. It's crazy.
Like, uninterrupted.
Just, yeah.
That's what they want to do. They want to make it uninterrupted. That's cool with me.
Yeah, so, and I think, I have a feeling we're going to get some sort of bigger demon character. I don't know if it's going to be Mephisto or K'thun or in... Agatha's coven that they talk about in the Midnight Suns, which is one of the ones that they recommend reading for this, is Valtor is another demon. So I don't know. Or in the Witch's Road comic, it's like chaos itself, basically. So I think we're going to get some demonic entities, though. We saw Goat in the trailer, like I said.
I mean, we'll see. That would be exciting if we got some sort of elder god, you know,
mm-hmm.
to come out. Because I really want these, you know, big, big, super bads to mm-hmm. show up in the MCU and using magic as a way to introduce some of these, you know, characters is really cool. I think that would be nice to see.
Yeah, I agree. Okay, now we get to the final circle of spoilers. So we're going to talk about teen guys and we're going to say things that they're probably going to be different than what we say, but there's probably going to be some spoilers here. So anyone who wants to go, spoilers. And okay. So all we know about him in this show for sure is that Agatha considers him her familiar, which, you know, her familiar in WandaVision was Senior Scratchy. So I wonder
what if that's her son.
Yeah. Oh. Hmm. If that's Nicholas Scratch. Oh, Senior Scratchy is...
Yes.
Why did I never put that together before?
Not saying that it is. I'm just saying, what if it is?
It's interesting. Yeah. Okay. I just want to point out that she has an awesome... I'm currently happen to be holding a black cat so that she doesn't rub against my microphone. But her in the comics, her familiar is a black cat named Ebony, who sometimes turns into a panther. But yeah, we know the teen is an Agatha fan in the show, is an Agatha fan. They actually call him teen because he can't say his own name. We got a glimpse of that in the trailer.
Agatha. Confession, I know an egregious amount about you. Been obsessed since I first showed up in your Salem days.
Who are you?
I'm...
Interesting.
Yeah, that was weird. but I think I know who it is.
Yes, we all think we know it is. So and I just want to say, in the comics, they did used to say things like warlock or wizard, but actually now they're shifting to modern parlance, where witch is not a gender specific word. So
right.
He is a witch, like the rest of them are witches. And we know he helps free him from his hex. But okay, Jean, who do we think Teen is?
Wiccan.
Yes.
Billy.
Mm-hmm. Billy Kaplan. And who is that?
That's somebody that should not exist. you could spoil it.
Yeah. Okay.
Go ahead. I give you the spoiler. But I don't know.
All right. We're spoiling the thing now. So in the comics, Wanda, as we said, she made her fake children and their souls got reabsorbed. And then they basically ended up being reincarnated, but sent back in time somehow. Who cares? The comics don't care how the exact mechanics of that. So they end up being raised by different families, Billy and Tommy. And then they find themselves later in the Young Avengers comics. And and then they figure out that they are actually reincarnations of these twins that are Wanda's and Vision's children, kind of. Yes, no.
Yes, it's complicated. Yes. They are.
Well, I'll say this is one of the things that Wanda's struggling with in the Witch's Road comic too, where she's like, I don't know how this whole situation's so complicated. How am I supposed to feel about this?
Yes. They are her children.
Mm-hmm. They are her children.
Nobody can
tell
me different.
But they're also other people's children as well.
No, yes.
So, yeah. So if you want to know more about this story, in addition to the Vision and Scarlet Witch comics that we talked about, also the Young Avengers Volume 1 from 2005, that's where they're first introduced in this new form and where they find each other. And then the Children's Crusade continuation from 2010 has another one of the biggest, most major chunks of that story. So I would start with those two to find out more about Billy Kaplan, who is probably Teen. I was even looking. Yeah.
Go ahead.
I was looking when he can't say his name. And I was watching his muscles twitch around his mouth.
Just trying to see if he's Billy.
There's four syllables. There's four syllables. He said Billy Kaplan.
But there's one thing I want to say is that Placebo is often referred to, like I said before, as the devil in the Marvel Universe. We shouldn't take everything that he says as true. Because he's the one that says that they were part of my soul.
Right.
Part of my essence that was split. He's telling her that.
Yeah. The comics have a long history of lying to Wanda.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And she's even, questioned whether that is truth.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't want to, I'm not saying that it's not true.
Right.
But
there's a high chance.
He is the devil.
Mm-hmm.
He is the devil. So let's take everything that he says with a grain of salt.
Yeah. Yep. I don't know, Gio, anything else that you wanted to throw out about the series, which you're looking forward to? Anything we didn't bring up?
No, I just really want to get a good story that doesn't have to deal with the things that we all know about the MCU. This is going to be a new part of the universe that's going to get major exposure. And I want that exposure to be really, really bright and really, really good.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? So they make more of these type of stories.
Right.
So that's what I'm looking forward to. Being wowed and coming away saying from it, I can't wait for the next iteration of this corner of the Marvel Universe.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, no, I mean, a lot of people have openly said that if this show weren't basically already made, there's a good chance it wouldn't have been in the current state of Marvel.
Right, so, exactly.
this, so it's important to me that it does well. And I think it's going to be good because WandaVision was good and we've got basically the same team and it's just got all of the recipes to be good. The cast is amazing. It just, everything I've seen looks amazing. But if it does well, that's our best hope for getting more.
More.
Yeah. And I would, you know, even I think like if it does well, that's going to do well for Blade because I want more Marvel horror. And yeah.
You had to say Blade. You just had to say Blade.
This is all tied together. Like I was just literally, yeah. I want Marvel horror to do well so that they make more of it. So, and more Man Thing. You guys know I'm going to be standing and screaming if Man Thing shows up.
I desperately want Blade. Desperately want Blade.
I know.
But I am so disheartened by the fact that we don't have Blade. And it looks further and further away
as they just canceled,
each day passes.
They just canceled Armor Wars, apparently.
Yeah, I heard about that. I didn't read the blurb of that.
Yeah.
But I heard that that's no longer on the slate.
Because they've got to pay the Russo brothers and Robert Downey. Shut up about that. I'll stop. I won't stop, but I'll stop for now. All right. Well, yeah. So I'm excited to cover this show with you, though. We're going to do weekly
coverage. Yeah, this is going to be fun. This is going to be fun. And I hope everybody joins us on the journey. This is going to be really, I think it's going to be good. I think it's going to be good.
Yeah. And we want your feedback also, as we said. So mcu@thelorehounds.com. Send us emails. Send us voicemails. We can drop them right in. We want this to be a conversation with the community. So
absolutely.
And as far as what else is going on in the network right now, well, obviously, David, John, and Marilyn are deep into Rings of the Power coverage. The Rings of Power coverage, yeah. And so we've got, you know, the regular episodes going out. There are every few episodes, there's feedback episodes going out on the public feed. And then on the subscriber feed, there are extra lore casts and a show guide. So, you know, you can find in the notes the links for Patreon and Supercast. Supercast, you can not only do the monthly subscription, but you can also do a season guide just for Rings of Power. But if you do the monthly subscription, all those places, you also get extra things like we're going to do have our second breakfast, which is like where we kind of talk shop and also talk about breakfast foods. It's going to be bagels this week. And also this month, it was my turn to propose movies for 11zs, the extra movie club for subscribers. And so this month's movie is going to be Prey, Predator movie.
Great movie. Great pick.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm excited to rewatch it. And on the main feed, Jean, you and I just put out the DCEU is dead. Long live the DCEU and Elseworlds.
Yes. And if you haven't watched Zack Snyder's Superman, go watch Zack Snyder. Go watch Zack Snyder's Superman. Go watch Man of Steel. Go.
Watch Shazam. Yeah, and we also have a new podcast that we have to shout out. We have Never Mind the Music, and that is two academics who are friends. We've got a specialist in songwriting and music theory and a psychology professor, and they just talk about like different artists through the lens of those things, but also just, you know, bullshitting and going on tangents and all the fun stuff. So they have their first three episodes out now on that feed. That's Never Mind the Music. And we've also got one shots coming up. We're doing this weekend. We're finally recording the Alien Romulus one shot.
Yeah, that's going to be fun.
Yeah. And there's also going to be next week Beetlejuice one shot coming up.
So that should be a good listen too.
Yeah, I'm excited about that. And of course, we need to... we want to thank those who are our top patrons. We like to thank on every episode our Discord server boosters who just give our Discord all the bells and whistles and make it faster so that we can do some extra things with it. And we also thank our lore masters, which is our highest tier of subscribers. And like, it's really it's with them where that's how we can, you know, take care of co-hosts and how we can pay for the software that we're using to record this right now and all these important things like that. So thank you so much. We like to play it with music because people seem to like it. So this is going to be a surprise. Let's see what we've got.
This is not the epic collection, is what you're saying?
No, this time I went for fantasy. So this first one is called Descent. Oh, it is still pretty epic. So thank you to our Discord server boosters, Gnarls, Aaron K, Tiller the Thriller, Dork of the Ninjas, Doove71, Captain Gingy 56, Athena Agilea, Adrian, Tina, Listu, Nancy M, and Ghost of Partition. And thank you also to our lore masters, Samartian, Michael G, Michelle E, David W, Brian P, SC, Peter OH, Bettina W, Adam S, Nancy M. Oh, we got to keep going, I think. This next one is called Lurking. It's very Lord of the Rings. Where did I stop? I said Peter H. Bettina W, Adam S, Nancy M, Doove71, Brian 8063, Frederick H, Sarah L, Gareth C, Eric F, Matthew M, Sarah M, DJ Miwa, Andra B, Kwang Yu, Jedi Jedi Bob, Nathan T, Alex V, Aaron T, Sub Zero, Aaron K, Dali V, Mothership 61, Gnarls, Kathy W, Listu, Jeffrey B, Elisa U, Facey U, Neil F, Ben B, Charlotte M, and always last, Adrian.
I have to disagree. I think that was an epic. That was from the epic folder. Because, Lordy,
that was. It sounded like some Lord of the Rings music there.
Let me get on my horse and ride into the battle. Let's go. But thank you to all.
And for those of you listening live, have a very witchy weekend and see you on the other side for Agatha All Along.
Recast T'Challa.
The Lorehounds podcast is produced and published by The Lorehounds. You can send questions and feedback and voicemails at thelorehounds.com/contact. Get early and ad-free access to all Lorehounds podcasts at patreon.com/thelorehounds. Any opinions stated are ours personally and do not reflect the opinion of or belong to any employers or other entities. We'll be right back.